All right, since a lot of people don't seem to understand why some fans are so upset at the Final Fantasy VII Remake, I'm going to break it down for you as quickly as possible. From the overall character changes to some of the greatest moments in the game already being partially ruined. Now, while I may hate what's happening in the remake, I still care that you do not get spoiled. While some aspects of Final Fantasy VII's story are well known, there are others that have been pretty well kept secret. So for that reason, if you haven't played the original yet, just watch this video another time. You can wait. It's not a big deal. First off, let's start with Midgar and how it looks and feels. In the original, it's a dark, dirty slum. Everything's broken. People's houses are made of shit. It's just a fucking dreary place. No natural sunlight. The only life that city had was in Aerie's flower garden and home, which is what made her so special and her stick out. The theme song in the slums is called Oppressed People. There's a dude just dying in a pipe. Everything fucking blows down there. The people are living in the constant shadow of the upper plate that holds up the richer populace. Shinra doesn't give a fuck about anybody down there. It's always miserable. The only dudes you see happy are the ones near Honeybee Inn. Even Barrett says something along the lines of, "We don't get any sunlight down here because of that damn pizza in the sky." And this all ties into the environmentalist message that the original game had. When you got to the world map and saw Midgar, it is completely dark and lifeless. There's no grass, there's no nothing. Even the music changes when you get too close. But now in the remake, everyone's happy, there's plenty of sunlight, you can even see the sky in some of the scenes. It's like they forgot the message of environmentalism the game had. Like, how could you forget? There's only two, environmentalism in life. Now moving on to the bigger stuff, like Sephiroth, and how they couldn't help but blow their load so early that the most ominous and powerful villain now looks like a bitch. You remember in the original, Sephiroth is never seen until the flashback in Calm. We only see the characters reference him in Shinra headquarters when they walk through the previously pristine environment, torn to shreds and covered in blood, something they forgot to add in the remake. Instead, we see Sephiroth every half hour to do some terrible voice acting and just come off as like a weird stalker. Yeah, like this scene right here. Remember the scene in the original Final Fantasy VII when Sephiroth tackles Cloud to the ground, looks him deep in the eye, and wants to give him a little give daddy a little kissy kiss. Oh, why'd you do that? You don't remember that? That's crazy. That's wild. That must have been in the original. That was a crucial scene, wasn't it? No? Yeah, I guess restraint and subtlety are just absent in this remake. If that wasn't enough, they decide to add the mon de piece de resistance of having you fight Sephiroth before you even leave Midgar. And this isn't some, we're gonna gen of a piece I'm gonna throw at you, or some nerfed version of Sephiroth. No, this is Advent children throwing buildings at you, world-ending level 99 Sephiroth. In the tutorial section of what was the original game. What the fuck are new players gonna give a shit about now? Are they gonna be threatened when Sephiroth turns into a big fish man? I cannot stress this enough. The final boss of the game has already been defeated. Are players really gonna care 2 to 3 games later when they just fight a different form of him? Look what he's doing now! He's gonna summon a meteor this time, so I guess he's a lot more scary. What the save it for the end! Save it for the end! Now that they've ruined the pacing and reveal of Sephiroth, let's move on to how they've ruined crucial character backstories, turning them into nerfed versions of their original selves. In the original Final Fantasy VII, only the second reactor bombing was a false flag created by Shinra. They did this because Avalanche was gaining support and they wanted the dead bodies caused by the plate collapsing that they were planning on to quell all future resistances. By destroying that first reactor, Barrett wasn't just a good guy, since he was kind of a murderer since several civilians died in the ensuing explosion. While we know Barrett's cause is just and the future of all life on Earth is kind of at stake, it still puts his character in the shades of gray as someone willing to kill innocents for the greater good. Barrett's story is also terribly tragic when players learn about what happened to his village of Coral. Shinra wanted to build a reactor there to replace the coal mines, and while the majority agreed to let Shinra build it since it would make their lives easier, including Barrett, one of the biggest dissenters was Dine, Barrett's best friend. But when an explosion at the reactor occurs, Shinra believes it to be caused by a group of the angry villagers, so they burn down Coral and kill most of the populace. Barrett and Dine come back to see the village being destroyed and are chased down by Shinra to a nearby mountain. While being shot at, Dine falls off the cliff but is held onto by Barrett, but unfortunately Shinra soldiers shoot off Barrett's arm, dropping him into the pit below, leaving Barrett with a permanent reminder of his arm of the destruction brought by Shinra. How if he never agreed to let Shinra build that reactor, this wouldn't have happened, and his failure to save his best friend. This makes Barrett's loss of Biggs, Wedge, and Jesse mean so much more, as it represents another failure by Barrett and the cost of his cause. Barrett's desire for revenge, the need to succeed in his cause, all his failures are personified in his arm. But now we see that Wedge has lived. Why? Who knows? We'll find out, I guess, in part two. Really fun, really great, guys. But now in the remake, Barrett is just some inept nut job with none of the grit the original character had. All the shades of gray the character used to have by being that killer are now gone. Now he's completely innocent. He's just a funny guy. Look at the funny guy.
Where could they be going? Embarking on an adventure to find some treasure?
But moving on from that, we're going to talk about the granddaddy of them all. The most offensive change in the remake that nearly ruins the greatest scene in Final Fantasy VII. The scene that was built for roughly 25 to 30 hours of gameplay. The most important scene of the entire game. Can you guess what it is? Because you better fucking know if you have any business watching this video. And that's the scene right here. When we find out about Cloud's true past. As Final Fantasy VII progresses, we clearly know something's wrong with Cloud. He keeps having these moments where he doesn't seem to be in control. He has episodes in the Shinra reactors at the start. He almost kills Aeris by Sephiroth's control. When he punches the shit out of Aeris like he's trying to win the UFC championship. When we reach Calm in the original, and Cloud goes over his backstory, we see what happened in Nibelheim where Sephiroth went crazy. However, Cloud's memory doesn't seem to hold up, as he can't remember how he survived. He went up to challenge Sephiroth, and then he just can't remember, and doesn't remember how he could have possibly survived, as Sephiroth is the greatest soldier who ever lived. Throughout the game, it's teased that maybe Cloud isn't even the Cloud Tifa remembers from her childhood. Is he a fraud? Is he a clone? Now, the line Cloud and Sephiroth say in Remake that ruins this moment may have passed you by, because you beat Final Fantasy VII before, you already know the whole story, you weren't thinking about how this fucks everything up. But for new players, the greatest scene in the game is already partially ruined, and here's what they say.
You're not real. You're dead.
I am.
I killed you with my own...
Oh, you need not remind me. It was the crowning moment of our time together.
Cloud has no business knowing that he's the one who killed Sephiroth this early. Half of the mystery of the flashback is now gone. Now, I'm gonna play the original scene because it gets my fucking dick hard every time and it's such a fucking great moment. Just so you can be in the same mindset as me. Our boy Cloud, only a Shinra guard, he never made it to Soldier. He failed in his dream, he failed his promise to Tifa. He's the same Shinra guard you kill in one hit in the beginning of the game. But just cause he's a loser doesn't mean he's not gonna pull a little something. Let's see what he does.
Thank you.
Oh man, that moment when the music swells up as soon as he picks up that fucking sword and throws Sephiroth into the Mako below. This was everybody's reaction when that shit happened. As a quick aside, I would like to mention how much of a shit company Square Enix is that for the last decade that Final Fantasy VII has been ported to PS3, PS4, Xbox, PC, they have never fixed a bug that played the wrong music during the scene. Instead, it plays the reactor theme, which just sucks the life out of the moment. It wasn't until late 2019 that this bug was fixed, and as far as I know, it's only for the Switch version of the game. So just fuck you, Square. How'd you fuck that up? Now, A, think about how they have to redo this scene for the remake, with the player now knowing that Cloud killed Sephiroth. And B, think about now that the player knows who Zack is, and that he's carrying a Buster Sword, that they can probably put together that it wasn't Cloud in that position back in the flashback. Kinda fucking ruins this stupid moment, doesn't it? Fucking Square. Now what kind of idiot would let this happen? What dumbass at Square Enix is responsible for this? Well, we already know the answer to that, and it's the 50-year-old man that looks like he fucked a Hot Topic, Tetsuya Nomura. The man who turned Kingdom Hearts into the raging clusterfuck that it is today. That you need to watch a 3-hour lecture on YouTube just to start understanding half of what the fuck is going on in that game. I'm not gonna be all negative either. I actually liked Kingdom Hearts 1 before it went fucking crazy. But how does anyone have any faith in this clown after that abortion of a storyline and what he's done so far in Remake? Everyone praises Remake for all the classic scenes from the original that were featured. And everyone shits on all the nonsense garbage like the time-traveling ghosts, expanded storylines for minor characters that no one cares about, those garbage Final Fantasy 15-tier side quests, and then this fucker right here. Who the fuck animated that? God damn, that was terrible. When you talk about the remake online, you're bound to see some comments that look like they've been copied straight out of a script. They always go something along the lines of, "Well, I admit I was disappointed at the end, but the more I thought about it, the more excited I began to feel for what's to come." Excited for what? More character establishing moments ruined? The conclusion of certain character arcs prematurely spoiled? More shitty new characters like Roche? The game's theme being crapped on every single minute? Sephiroth ruined even more? I still don't get why they changed the theme of the game to Destiny and Fate. Like this is the most generic anime ever made. Oh, Destiny and Fate, it's my destiny to fight each other forever. And shut up, bro. It's about life. It's about the end of life. Death. How people cope with it and move on. Cloud copes with everything by taking the persona of Zack, because his brain is so fucked up that Tifa has to go into it through the live stream just to get him back to normal, just so he can accept everything that happened in Nibelheim. The death of his dream, the death of his mom, Tifa almost dying, and 5 years of experimentation by Hojo. But no, we can't have that. We gotta have Cloud and Sephiroth in a cool scene where they talk to each other and spoil certain events in the future. I don't know why, whatever. Besides all of this, the thing that pisses me off the most is how new players to Final Fantasy VII are forever gonna have this game as the benchmark. Final Fantasy VII is an old game, and players nowadays aren't really gonna go back because, "Oh, ATB is so hard, I can't understand pressing X, and the graphics, why are they so blocky, I don't understand." But now there are millions of people playing Final Fantasy VII Remake who will enjoy the game, and I'm not getting mad at you for enjoying the game. The game is not that bad. What's really bad is how they changed the story around and ruined certain characters' arcs and pacing, which just, oh my god, I don't know how they're gonna fix this in the sequels. It's kind of fucking botched already. And there are a million others who have played this game and said, "This is supposed to be the best game of all time. This 80-whatever rating Metacritic game. Bro, your taste is fucking trash, bro. Oh my god." And it just kills me inside that new players will think they're getting the same experience I did, but they aren't. They're getting an imitation with some terrible changes. And if you say, "Oh, it's the same game, they just expanded on it, why are you being so overdramatic?" Then you clearly haven't been paying attention to this video because you need to get your fucking head checked. "Oh, I can't wait to see alternate timeline Zack, whose original existence was to develop Cloud and have his life continue after death through his dreams that he instilled in Cloud, which is part of the theme of the fucking game." You know what? If you're not gonna listen to me, let's listen to Hironobu Sakaguchi, the guy who directed Final Fantasy 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the story writer and producer of 6 and 7, and 8, 9, 10. Oh, wait, no. I mean, this guy, he's nobody, but let's see what he has to say.
"My mother passed away, and ever since I have been thinking about the theme life. Life exists in many things, and I was curious about what would happen if I attempted to analyze life in a mathematical and logical way. Maybe this was my approach in overcoming the grief I was experiencing. This is the first time in the series that this particular theme actually appears in the game itself. See if you can spot it.